Most people in life are looking for how do they make a retirement worth having. They're also looking at how to keep a life worth living. The reality is we all must work in order to do that, and we all must produce ourselves in a way that makes sense to the world, as well as it makes sense to our potential clients. In my life, I've been practicing an interesting marketing tactic of seeing how people react to a man with a long beard. It's sort of a marketing shtick in a way because I'm learning how people react to someone that they either know is homeless or feel is homeless, and how they treat them in the land. You see, we have monstrous men in positions of power who try to harm a person. We have women who will taint their food, and we have other people who will steal possessions from their belongings if they, God forbid, fall asleep in a moment of narcolepsy or in just in pure out fatigue from walking the community through difficult streets that are hard to maneuver and literally have no place to sit for the elderly. When we're talking about these rights, we're talking about fundamental human dignities. We're also talking about the Human Rights Declaration of the international treaties that are signed into effect by 300 to 400 nations of the globe with the smartest minds in humanitarian efforts that need to be looked at. When I'm talking like this, I have the right to do so because I'm literally in a public space. I'm in a library of sorts, and I'm allowed to do that because I have gentle, kind people who are in this room with me, not minding the fact that no one else is present at the moment and that I can utilize the space to make a recording in the silence of the room. When I'm talking like this, I'm talking as a man who is literally a trained journalist from one of the leading universities in journalism schools. I'm also an old-time writer, and I know how to produce information for corporations in a way that makes sense to their employees so that the presidents and the management don't piss them off with their leadership attitudes. You see, whenever we're producing anything in the world, we have to produce it for the audience who's listening. If only a handful of people are listening, those are who the people that God has chosen to listen at that moment in time, so that they might get a movement in their mind of what needs to occur and what needs to happen. There are other people who don't understand things as absolute truth. But the legalities and liabilities of employees is something we have to really look at in this land, because we are hiring not only illegal people to do jobs that they should not be doing because they are not properly trained in laying foundations of houses or in putting down gravel, or literally laying roads down that it causes us problems later, but even in cases like my father did before he was still alive, in putting in a huge monument for our community and working tirelessly in his elderly years to volunteer his time to solicit funds to get people to invest, someone did a bad thing and gave them the wrong style bricks. So those bricks have started to fall apart, and they all have to be refurbished now. That was a failure of the people who sold to the community. It was also a failure of people who were budgeting, perhaps, but I doubt it was my father's failure, and I'm pretty sure he probably wanted the best of the best. But in life, we have moments of time to listen to people, we have moments of time to ruin their lives, and we have moments of time to do things that make amends. And when we don't make amends with people, we create animosity in the world. I literally was in a public institution for Indiana the other day, and I was put upon by a man who runs the overall building. He had no right to literally know that I was about to eat lunch. I had literally just sat down to eat my lunch because I was told I couldn't do it in the workplace that I was in, and openly he started to solicit me for information like he had some right to know why I was there, what I was doing, how long I would stay, and whether or not he would allow me to participate in the use of an Indiana state institution. I found that beyond offensive. Now, if I were to mention the name of that college, it would look bad for them. So as a reporter, I'm not going to do that, but I'm going to say that that man's boss got a call already. In life, we have moments of time to take action, to let people know about fairness, to express our discontent and our displeasement with how we're treated in a place, because if one person does it, it's one thing. If that person has a pattern of doing it, but no one ever reports them, it means the abuse continues on, and people do get abused in those situations. I literally have had food stolen from my bag by falling asleep in that community. I literally have papers moved around in my property, and I've had things for sale go missing, all when I went to the bathroom, simply trusting that an employee of an institution might be a little mindful of who would possibly go near my desk, so I didn't have to lug it all into the men's room and be ridiculous about it. Men don't carry purses. We carry briefcases. We carry suitcases with our information. We do all sorts of work, and it's not someone's right to literally get into our files, get into our bags, or do anything like that in this land. They have no right to unlawfully enter our property. They have no right to unlawfully touch our bodies and get into our pockets. Yet we have men, women, and family members who think they have the lawful right to do that, which they don't. These are violations of international human rights dignities, and we have to pay attention to this. What's going on in Georgia is sort of a violation of that international treaty, and we know that states are bound to follow, as best they can, the human treaties of the world. And what I mean by that is that men and women make those treaties. They think about it carefully for long periods of consternation, and then they come up with a proposal that everyone across the land and across the world, in some cases, can agree to. Or it's something between two superpowers, in cases of states to another nation, in terms of sister cities and other things. So we have to really look at, are we representing our state well if we're violating a human rights treaty where women have rights to their own bodies, which is clearly outlined in that international human rights amendment, if you will. And I get the words wrong because I am not a lawyer. But a person who is a lawyer knows how to lead a land because they know what the laws are, they know how to regard human life, and they openly know what to do and what to say to not harm another individual. Now, when I'm talking as a reporter, but I might look like an old Harley man because that is the shtick I'm in right now. But there's always someone trying to put a play on my life, and they don't get how quick I get who they are. They provide way too much information, they provide the wrong information, or they provide information too similar to my own life story that it makes it unnatural. I have solicited no one in this community for anything ever is pretty true. But when I was working and had a company, I was allowed to do that. It's an interesting thing we have these laws of no solicitation in neighborhoods and no solicitation to businesses, and yet we are all in life regarding our need to have employment, our need to not only be employed, but our need to produce a business result so that we have food on the table and a roof over our heads and clothes on our children and family households to care for. So let's be really clear about the laws of the land, that this is a nation of freedom reigns, and freedom means I have the right to my own personhood, my own paperwork, my own property, and no other human being has the little right to take it away from me. No other legal entity should be allowed to do that if they don't allow me the proper rights to defend myself against something like that. And openly, we have some major problems in Indiana with regard to that. And we have to be careful of the fact that the lawmen here are representing mayors who represent the nation in some way in those international human rights treaties. Now, when I talk about this, I'm sure this part of my video will be cut because someone keeps getting onto my YouTube channel, deleting my videos, which is illegal, and openly editing my video footage, taking out pieces that I put in intentionally through my own intellectual property rights, my own copywriting of my work, to provide to people as a journalist and as a reporter, as an author, as a podcaster, as an audiocaster, and as a video man, if you will. So in life, I don't have to produce every pretty picture of myself is absolute true. The fact that I'm authentic and transparent and show myself in this moment of state is authentic. If you've seen any of my previous videos, you know that in 2015, I was going quite well into the world. But openly, someone hit my life with illegal activity and destroyed my records, and literally, it's been a downhill spiral. The truth is that what happens to me could potentially happen to you if we allow this to continue in the land where people can lie, steal, and cheat a person out of a life. We have a lot of people who are here not legally, is somewhat true. But we also have to be mindful of the fact that we are legally liable for our mouths, and when we make an inappropriate comment to someone who we think is our pal, and we discover that they want to take that information and use it to abuse a person, we have to be very mindful that we have a legal liability to that. My own siblings are in legal liabilities right now with me because of their lies in my name, which they had no lawful right to provide to anyone whatsoever, their violations of HIPAA law, and also other people in this community who continue to think they have the right to manhandle a man who's going through a challenge. We can't have people in a community not willing to help others. I literally sat within a congregation the other night, I communicated my challenge, and not one person said, "Hey, do you have a place to be? Hey, how are you going to handle the rain tonight? Hey, have you had supper?" Not one. This is what Hamilton County is apparently about, or at least in that particular denomination of church. So when I talk about churches, it's because I'm talking about real experience of going places to worship, to find a place to fellowship for the long term, and openly, all I find are people who are willing to lie, steal, and cheat a man out of that right to God. That is an offense, because no matter what your religion is, no matter what your faith is, in the land of America, underneath the U.S. Constitution, we have the right to fellowship, the right to faith, the right to believe in anything, the right to use any tool we choose to honor the Lord God in heaven. And frankly, it's outlandish that some people think they've got a direct line to God. The man's proposition last night was, "How do we know if we're on God's path?" but he provided no response with regard to Jesus knows what our path is supposed to be. It's supposed to be of love, honor, dignity, and regard for all human life. It's supposed to allow the Lord to be the Lord over that individual and the individual to have power in their own bodies, personhood, paperwork, and property. But we seem to have a mixed bag of what people are willing to follow with regard to federal and international law versus what they want to do in their own opinions on life locally. So when I'm talking like this, I'm trying to communicate to politicians that they need to participate in talking about things that matter to the common man. The common man is, of course, concerned with our safety in the global economy and the global world. But the truth is, Indiana farmers produce most of the food not only in our state, but probably towards the rest of the world. The United States provides food to tons of countries of which we receive automobiles, electronics, and other things from. Those countries don't have enough food production in their realms to do it, and we participate in that with farms. Farms need to be protected, livestock needs to be cared for, and openly we have new science technologies out there that biohack the body that can prolong life to a point. There's no promise of curing any diseases, there's no promise of curing or preventing any illnesses from coming on, but I can say in my own father's life, the PSP that he had that should have taken him in a year took 7+ years to take his demise, and that's pretty good for me. Preventive maintenance health is what everyone needs to do because we all age, all of our cells start to die, and we all produce elder years illnesses and animosities perhaps, and sometimes deficits in the mind. That certainly is what happens in the feebleness, such as why we have people, ombudsmen, and others who try to protect elderly, but sometimes the people who say they're protecting the elderly are really lying just to have a manipulative control in the elderly's life. And I've seen that in my own family. I warn children about it. I warn parents about it. I warn Christians about it. I warn anyone who will listen about it that they need to produce loving relationships with their children in the earliest of years, before age 3, perhaps, teaching them what is right and what is not right. And the fact that a child can go running with scissors towards cutting a little girl's hair without a parent paying attention is a real problem today. I literally had to stop that yesterday, and I'm an old man who doesn't know those people at all. But I am smart enough to know about childcare from reading books, from having been a babysitter since the age of maybe 10, and frankly, having run a language school where children of all ages, shapes, sizes, and parts on the spectrum participated, even to the point of being honored with the right to teach for some 16 seasons, if you will, for IUPUI Continuing Learning Network, which I'm not sure is still there. I also was given the right to participate in the administration of Ivy Tech when it was in Carmel, and I was honored to do that until it was no longer a fit for my life or my own spiritual health because of new management coming in. Now, when I talk like this, I'm talking about a real story, a real life, but there's always someone who wants to take that life, pretend it's their own, and it's not. When I talk about the theft and the difficulties in my storage unit, it is literally happening. But that needs to stop too, because the people doing it are violating federal law. They're also violating international human rights law that says no one has the right to take away someone's property. So when I talk about these topics, I'm talking about things that are dear to my heart, because I have the right, just as you have the right, to bestow those items of our personal wealth and personal property on the people we choose, the people we love, the people we want to honor with their donation. And no one has the right to choose they're going to take donations away from another individual. I sent books to a church in honor of someone that I love dearly, and I promise you that someone infiltrated that conversation with the people who were helping me in that moment of my illness and literally put books back that I wanted to get rid of. Who gave them the right to do that? There are monsters in the land, and sometimes they're in our families, and we decide, you know, I'm not interested in you anymore because you do not honor the laws of the land, you do not honor God in heaven, allowing everyone to be loved by the Lord, and you do not show me any regard for my rights in this world. And that's what people have the right to say. You have the right to say it. I have the right to say it. Politicians have the right to fight for us for it. And that's what we're looking for in a president. We're looking for someone who will fight for the rights of all human beings, no matter who they are, no matter what they look like, no matter what they choose to do with their own body, their own paperwork, their own property. It is our lawful right as American citizens to be live and free and not put upon by others' ideas about their rights in our life. The situation in Georgia is out of control to a point, because the God in heaven will guide a woman to what she can and cannot handle in her life. There are children who need parents. That we be better parented by other people is absolute truth. The fact that our parenting strategies are failing us is pretty true, because children are lazy who have children young. They don't read about parenting. They don't read about the education and establishment of a child at the different ages and stages of what a child's development is. And that's how we get undereducated, unimportant people, is not true. It's how we get immature children of the land who lie, steal, and cheat because no one in their life ever taught them right from wrong. Now, this has been a person from a company in a community in Indiana talking about rights. And I look forward to hearing your feedback of what you think of this little old man in his furry beard while he's going to wear it and not have someone think they have the right to shave it without his consent or get into his medical care without his consent. Yet I have family members who thought they had the right to do that, and they did not. We have police that allow that crap, and we need to put an end to that immediately. The land of America is about being born free, of being mobbed, of being stalked, of being harmed, of being ticketed, of being tagged like an animal, of being followed like one and stalked like one, like a deer hunter would. And openly, we need to protect every human being for their rights to their own paperwork, their own property, and most importantly, their own personhood in terms of their rights to their own human body. No human being has the right to come in and lend an opinion off of 5 minutes of conversation when they have not participated in the lifetime care of that individual's life. This, again, has been a human being reporting from Indianapolis, Indiana, literally a suburb just north of that in Noblesville, looking for a job in reporting, in political consulting, and telling these politicians that they're missing half the population in their little 30-something social media managers who are not paying attention to what they're making those people sound like because they still have alliances to old candidates, instead of providing someone who really desperately needs a job the right to help them.